Hey everybody, welcome back to the mailbag. In today's video, I'm going to demonstrate how to pack your backpack for traveling in avalanche terrain. We are using the Action X50. The primary reason for that is because the Action X50 is the best bag for backcountry travel in avalanche terrain. The main reason for that is the size of the front pocket, but also the overall volume. I think when you consider all the gear you have to bring just to travel in avalanche terrain, a 30 liter pack won't do the job because you've also got your camera gear and your avalanche safety tools. It's definitely better to have more space when you're traveling in complicated terrain because you need the option to pack more and you need the option to kind of what I consider panic packing, where you're in dangerous terrain or the weather's really cold, the wind's really blowing, and you need to be able to just stuff and throw things in your bag. If you have a 30 liter pack, you're not really gonna have that option and you're really just gonna make it harder on yourself than it really needs to be. So let's get started here. We got the X50. We're gonna start with the essentials, which is going to be the avalanche shovel. You can see right here, of course, avalanche shovels, when they're in use, they're assembled like this. The handle extends to this length. There's many different size avalanche shovels. Personally, I really highly recommend you go on the medium to bigger. There is an argument for smaller ones, but in my experience, medium to bigger is the way to go. You'll wanna make sure your shovel is collapsed because we need to fit it into the bag. The first thing we're gonna do is open the top pocket. And we are just gonna put the shovel in just like this. Now, before I pack the rest of the bag, depending on the shape of your shovel, they all have these different concave, and some are deeper, some are flatter, so they're all gonna fit in your pack differently. But if you have one that takes up a lot of volume or tends to create a strange shape inside the bag, you have the option to flip it upside down. And in some cases, that will buy you more packing space. For this demonstration, I'll just pack it normally. Put it in like that. I'll take the handle, slide that in. Next, I'll take my probe. This is a 280 centimeter size. I think for folks with a little more backcountry experience, they might choose their probe based on the terrain they travel in. For instance, coast mountains tend to get a deeper, thicker snowpack that when there is avalanches, more heavier snow might slide down the mountain and stack up taller, and it might require a bit of a longer probe. I think the smallest size they make is 240. I'm not sure if that's still the case, but try to avoid that size. This is a 280. And then I think there's a couple just over 300. The reason that's relevant to when you're packing your bag is because you only have so much height with the front pocket. But if you are in this situation where you're using a really long probe and you put it in the bag, and let's just say for demonstration's sake that you're finding it's a little too high, just angle the probe like this. That will buy you some extra space. We don't have to worry about that today. So let's just close up the front pocket. And there you go. Those are your two primary avalanche tools inside your front pocket. Now I do have the medium DSLR core unit inside, which is gonna take up the max depth of the pack. If you use a mirrorless core unit in here, you will have a little more depth in that pocket to put more gear. Let's move on to what I would consider the secondary supplies and where we will pack those. We're gonna move up to the upper pocket right here. And we're gonna start with a couple of things that I think you probably will have. One is a set of goggles, a set of gloves, and of course, a down jacket. With the gloves specifically, usually, at least myself, I'll usually have a pair of liner gloves underneath these. And these particular gloves made by a brand called 10 Peaks are really good for photography, but they're also just good for skiing and snowboarding. Of course, these are mittens, but they also make glove versions. And the reason they're so good is because they have this zipper here, and you can pop your hand out just like this. And if you're holding a ski pole or a touring pole, you have that option to hold it like this. But if it gets a little chilly, you can just put the mitt over, and you can somewhat regulate the temperature and let your finger breathe so it doesn't get too hot and sweaty. And then when it is really cold or snow is blowing, just seal it up. Now again, I will have like a liner so I can use my phone at the same time, but also operate my camera. Depending on the length of the tour, the weather, the terrain, I may or may not have these on, but for the sake of this, let's just say I'm not wearing them. I'll put these in the top compartment of my bag, but usually I will also put my goggles in there, keep them nice and protected. I'll try and stack both my goggles and my gloves so they're not on top of each other, but they're more sitting in the bag like this, so I don't have to remove one or the other to get at them. So I'll put them in there, and then I will just stuff my jacket on top. Now you want to be considerate of what's on top and what's on the bottom. I'll access this down jacket when I get to the transition point, when we're say taking a break or changing over from ski tour mode into descent mode. I will throw my down jacket over my shell to stay warm. And then when I'm actually ready to drop in and go snowboarding, I'll stuff the jacket back in the bag. So having it on top just makes it quick, easy access and a lot less stress in windy situations. I often refer to our top pockets as a bucket because you can just throw things in the bucket and quickly get rid of them. Now let's consider some other tools we might need in the mountains, perhaps crampons. If I know I'm traveling through crampon terrain that day, I am going to put these in the upper compartment but at the bottom of the bag, because access to those will probably come at one point during the day to put them on and another point to take them off, and that's probably going to be it. So of course, pack to your needs. Then I'll put the gloves, the goggles, and stuff the jacket on top. Now there's one other way we can manage our crampons, and that is by attaching them to the base of the bag. So I'll just quickly show you how you do that. The best bag for this is the Black Diamond crampon bag. This bag's been out for years and I'm pretty sure it's still the same as it was when I picked this one up probably over 10 years ago. So it has these loops on the bottom, you can see right here, and these loops are perfect to thread through an accessory strap. So you'll attach the accessory straps to the loops just like this. Also secure it to the bottom. Give it a little slack. Make sure the adjustment webbing is on the outside. Lock the gatekeeper clip and take your bag. It's gonna be easier if I do this upside down. Let's just thread the buckle through here like this. Secure that. The other side. So now that's at the bottom. If we put the pack on, hopefully you can see the crampons are just a little off the behind here. So that's another way you can attach crampons to the bag. Now the benefit of putting it on the outside of the bag is that crampons are generally metal spikes. If you can see closely here, the spikes are actually popping through the mesh. But more importantly, after you use the crampons, there's a good chance there's going to be snow and moisture sticking to them. And over time, that snow is going to either melt and drip off, and it's just nicer to have it drip outside back into the environment rather than back into your bag. Now there's many different ways you can get around the backcountry. Probably the most efficient is with skins on. Skins of course give you the traction to climb uphill with either your skis or splitboard on your feet. So they're quite an essential tool for backcountry, and they also get wet. So I personally do not use a bag or cover for them, and I do not use the skin paper, which is used to protect the sticky adhesive. I personally have never found a need for that, and it's quite a pain in the butt if it's windy or there's just variable weather going on. So I don't use it. I just fold my skins over like this, and then I'll take both of them and I'll press them down as flat as possible. Open the front pocket. And just tuck them in just like that. Keep in mind that ski skins might be a bit longer inside the front pocket. Depending on how your skins fit, when you pack your bag, you may want to invert that shovel blade. Next, if we are packing your skis, we're going to need poles. I use these Black Diamond poles. They break down really small, and I think the intention here is to put them inside your bag. Personally, I don't do that, so I don't ever really pack them down this small. I prefer to pack them down into sections of two like this. There's a couple different reasons for that, because when we put the compression straps down, we want to make sure it's covering the actual pole. So we do want a bit of length to them. If they're short, they're going to be flapping around like this. So when you do this, take the wrist leashes, take your upper compression strap, make sure you thread it through the leashes, and then just close it down like that. And these will be nice and secure when you're descending, or maybe if you're scrambling or boot packing. Now the next tool we're gonna pack on this backcountry journey is your ice axe. You may or may not travel in terrain where you need one of these, but if you do, it's very simple to attach one of these. Just drop it down through the loop, stand it up like this, and just roll it nice and tight, and then lay it down, and then you'll take the upper compression strap, secure it down like this, and tighten it if you need to. Now, of course, you have the option for the left or right side. The idea of there is just to have the option, because some days you're not gonna have space in this pocket to have it on this side comfortably, or the other side. And there might also be situations where you don't have the option to use either of these loops, and you might just wanna stick it in the side panel like this. You might be exhausted, you might be just feeling lazy and just wanna put it there. If you have a safety leash on your axe, highly recommend threading it through the compression strap. And the last way to store your axe is when it's actually in use and you're wearing the pack. For example, if you're on an icy ridge, you got crampons on and you're holding your glacier style axe, but you need access to your hands. Maybe it's a scramble, maybe you wanna take a picture or something. Just drop it in the gear loop here and you have both of your hands free. Another situation where this comes in handy is whether you're ascending or descending, you can just drop it down and have access to your camera. Last two things here, this is probably not enough water for a day out, but this pocket right here will hold up to a 750 millimeter bottle. There's a bottle made by Camelback called the Podium, which is a really good water bottle. It fits in here, 750 millimeters. So you do get quite a bit of water. With that bottle, you can literally just drink like this. Unfortunately, I don't have one in the studio right now. And the other thing is, of course, I'll always put my phone right here, so I have access to that when I need it, whether it's quick snaps or just checking some data on the internet. Now, of course, I don't have any food packed in here right now. You're definitely gonna want food in there. There is space in the upper compartment for food. If you are running tight on space, don't be afraid to use your core unit, because your core unit's not just for your camera gear. You can use it really for anything that you need to carry. So on that note, I hope everyone has an amazing and safe winter, and we'll see you next time on the mailbag. Take care.